Good afternoon. This is Dr. John Bennett from Neurosurgical TV headquarters in Miami Beach. We have the pleasure of having another Association of Future Neurosurgeons of Africa presentation with Zolo Yvonne, a medical student who works hard. We had him work last week doing an hour presentation, or actually 2 hours. Today he's going to be discussing brain injury and acute hydrocephalus. And we're graced by the presence of Dr. Cabullo. Hi, Dr. Cabullo.
Hi, Dr. Bennett.
Could you please introduce yourself?
Thank you. My name is Cabullo from Democratic Republic of Congo. Currently, I'm final year neurosurgery resident at the University of Zimbabwe.
He's one of the main mentors of this channel. Nathalie, welcome. Go ahead, unmute there, Nathalie. Okay, go ahead. Oh, hold on.
I am.
Okay, we can hear you now.
Hello, I'm Nathalie Christophe Gomsi. I'm a general practitioner and member of Future for Neurosurgeons.
Very good. Welcome, Nathalie. And Dr. Doc Panu, welcome. Your camera's not working, could you please introduce yourself? Tell where you're from, etc.
Yes, sir. I'm Dr. Dokono Christian. I'm from Benin Republic. Neurosurgery resident of the WFNS of Morocco.
Oh, welcome. An associate of Dr. Nehru.
Actually, I'm back to my country. I'm on holiday.
Okay, welcome. Welcome anytime. Okay, Zolo, thank you for preparing this and welcome, and it's all yours.
Hello, Dr. Bennett. Hello to all the panelists. It's a pleasure being here. I am Zolo Ivan. I am a CTM medical student from the University of Buya in Cameroon. Thank you. So I think I'll just move directly to the presentation. So I'll be presenting from my phone, my smartphone.
Excellent.
So so let me share my screen.
Okay. We can see you're orienting the screen now.
All right. Okay, so the presentation is management of traumatic brain injury, and is given by me, Zolo Ivan, a member of the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons, a medical student from the Faculty of Health Sciences, University of Buya. So let's start. We are going to follow this plan. We are going to have an introduction, give an idea about the epidemiology, the pathology, the management, the prognosis, the prevention, and you are going to see head injury in children. Then you are going to speak about some complications, and we are going to conclude, and I'll give you my references. So the silent epidemic of modern time, which is also traumatic brain injury, is defined as damage to the brain resulting from external mechanical force, such as rapid acceleration or deceleration, impact, blast waves, or penetration by a projectile. Head injury is a damage to other structures such as the scalp and skull. Traumatic brain injury is thus a subset of a head injury, and the traumatic brain injury can result in brain function being temporarily or permanently impaired, and also structural damage the structural damages caused by traumatic brain injury may not be detectable at the early stages in some cases. So the outcome can range from complete recovery to permanent disability and even death. And in addition, a variety of events following the injury may result in further injury. So these processes include alterations in cerebral blood flow and the pressure with and the alterations also in the pressure within the skull. So apart from the history of the patient and physical examination, some imaging techniques are used to for diagnosis, and this image includes computed tomography and the magnetic resonance imaging of the head. The treatment required may be supportive or may include medications, emergency surgery, or surgery years after. So somebody having a traumatic brain injury, he might have some sequelae that might need some surgical interventions years after the injury, and some might need rehabilitation measures after the management of these traumatic brain injuries. So, because of its serious implications, prevention remains the key. And prevention measures include use of seatbelts and helmets, avoid drinking and driving, all prevention efforts in older adults. You know that in patients who are older, one of the main causes of traumatic brain injury is fall. So, and also safety measures for children. Traumatic brain injury is an acquired brain injury, and first of all, together with non-traumatic brain injury, and thus, this traumatic brain injury is a CNS injury and a form of neurotrauma. Sorry, I put the neurotransmission. It is actually neurotrauma. It's a typing error. So there are various classifications of traumatic brain injury using various criteria, and one of the classification is based on the severity. Then we can classify it as being mild, moderate, and severe. And here we use the Glasgow Coma Scale. We use the level, the loss of consciousness. We also use post-traumatic amnesia. And another classification criteria is based on the anatomical features of the injury. We also have the mechanism of the injury and the pathological features of the injury. All this helps us to orientate the treatment given to the patient. So the GCS is the most commonly used system for classifying traumatic brain injury severity. And a GCS of 13 or above is considered as mild, while a GCS between 9 to 12 is moderate, and below an 8 or below 8 is considered as severe. A GCS grading system has limited ability to predict outcomes. Thus, after resuscitation, duration of post-traumatic amnesia and the loss of consciousness are also used to help us orientate and to help us classify the severity of a traumatic brain injury. It has also been proposed to use changes that are visible on neuroimaging. So they're using the different techniques that have been mentioned earlier, computer tomography and MRI. And some of these changes that we can see are swelling, focal lesions, or diffuse injury. And we use all this as a method of classifying the severity of traumatic brain injury. A grading scale also exists to classify the severity of mild traumatic brain injury, commonly called concussion. So another name for mild traumatic brain injury is concussion. And these use the duration of the loss of consciousness, a post-traumatic amnesia, and other concussion symptoms. So here we have a small table that helps us to have an idea of what I just said. So if you see here for mild, you see the GCS is between 13 to 15. And the post-traumatic amnesia is less than 1 day, while the loss of consciousness is between 0 to 30 minutes. While in moderate, we have a GCS of 9 to 12. Post-traumatic amnesia is greater than 1 to less than 7 days, while the loss of consciousness is greater than 30 minutes to 24 hours. And then for severe, we have a GCS between 3 to 8. Post-traumatic amnesia greater than 7 days, and the loss of consciousness of 24 hours. This is very important because you cannot only use one criteria to classify a severity. It might give you some wrong information, but when you combine all these three, it helps you to have a better idea about the severity of your patient. So for diffuse injury, they manifest with little apparent damage in neuroimaging, and it can be seen more on diffuse tensor imaging, which is a way of processing MRI images. So focal injuries often produce symptoms related to the function of the damaged area. So depending on the part of the brain that is being affected, you are going to have a focal manifestation of focal injuries. And then hematomas, which are focal lesions, we have intracerebral hemorrhage with bleeding in the brain tissue itself. It's an intraaxial lesion. If you see, there was some classification of brain injuries above. So this is where hematomas fall. Intraaxial lesion. So extraaxial lesions include epidural hematoma, subdural hematoma, subarachnoid hemorrhage, and intraventricular hemorrhage. So to have an idea about the epidemiology, about 1.7 million cases of traumatic brain injury occur in the US every year. So it's a bit difficult to have much information concerning Africa due to the reasons we all know. So the values we have, the beta values we have, are those from the United States. And approximately 5.3 million people live with a disability caused by traumatic brain injury in the US alone. So you can have an idea about how traumatic brain injury is important. And as we said earlier, it's a form of epidemic, actually. So annual direct and indirect traumatic brain injury costs are estimated at 48 to 56 billion US dollars. And there are about 235,000 hospitalizations for traumatic brain injury every year, which is more than 20 times the number of hospitalizations for spinal cord injury. Among children ages 14 and younger, traumatic brain injuries account for an estimated 2,685 deaths, while 37,000 hospitalizations and 437,000 emergency room visits. So every year, 80,000 to 90,000 people experience the onset of long-term or lifelong disabilities associated with traumatic brain injury. And males represent 78% of all reported traumatic brain injury accidents, and females represent 21.2%. So the national statistics estimate between 50 to 70% of traumatic brain injury accidents are a result of motor vehicle crash. And the sports and recreational activities contribute to about 21% of all traumatic brain injuries among American children and adolescents. The mortality rate for traumatic brain injury is 30 per 100,000, or an estimated 50,000 deaths in the United States annually. Of those who die, 50% do not do so within the first hour of the injury, which is also considered as the golden hour. So deaths from head injuries account for 34% of all traumatic deaths. Beginning at the age 30, the mortality risk after head injury begins to increase, and persons ages from 60 and older have the highest death rate after traumatic brain injury, primarily because of falls, which have a rising incidence in the in this age group. So with all this, you actually see that traumatic brain injury is a very important burden to the healthcare system. So that's it. We are going to move directly to the pathology. So the initial stage after traumatic brain injury results from direct tissue damage and impaired auto-regulation of cerebral blood flow, along with disordered metabolism. We saw this in the last week's presentation. This state, similar to ischemia, may lead to accumulation of lactic acid, increased cell membrane permeability, and subsequent edema. Since anaerobic metabolism cannot sustain the demands of the brain, adenosine triphosphate stores are depleted, which ultimately results in failure of the ATP-dependent membrane ionic pumps, which are essential for maintaining adequate homeostasis. This is what Dr. Ulrich spoke about last week's presentation. So the second stage of this cascade is characterized by sustained membrane depolarization along with excitotoxicity and the activation of voltage-dependent calcium ion and sodium ion channels. The subsequent calcium and the sodium influx results in the activation of lipid peroxidases, proteases, and phospholipases, which trigger the apoptotic cascade and ultimately to the membrane degradation and cell death. So extracerebral organ dysfunction may be triggered and promoted by systemic inflammation following traumatic brain injury. And it has been suggested that the catecholamine surge following traumatic brain injury is directly involved in upregulation of cytokine levels and may contribute to systemic organ dysfunction. Endocrine, respiratory, and cardiac dysfunction are common, while renal and hepatic manifestations are unusual. The most important of these organ dysfunction in the acute setting is neurogenic pulmonary edema, which is also related NPE. And this neurogenic pulmonary edema can develop immediately or during the 14 days following traumatic brain injury. So after traumatic brain injury, don't believe that maybe because your patient seems to be good, the patient is out of danger. So it leads to this leads to increased extravascular fluid in the lungs that cause hypoxia and decreased compliance. The vascular tone of the pulmonary vessel is thought to increase as a consequence of catecholamine storm that occurs after traumatic brain injury and results in increased intravascular pressure and hydrostatic edema. So in other words, large percentages of people killed by brain trauma do not die right away. and the rather days to weeks after the event. Rather than improving after being hospitalized, some 40% of traumatic brain injury patients deteriorate, and primary brain injury is not adequate to explain this deterioration. Rather, it is caused by secondary injury, which is a complex set of cellular processes and biochemical cascades that occur in minutes to days following the traumatic brain injury. So these secondary processes can dramatically worsen the damage caused by primary injury and accounts for the greatest number of traumatic brain injury deaths. And these include damage to the blood-brain barrier, release of factors that cause inflammation, free radical overload, excessive release of the neurotransmitter glutamate, influx of calcium and sodium ions into neurons, and the dysfunction of the mitochondria. Also, other factors include changes in the blood flow to the brain, ischemia, cerebral hypoxia, cerebral edema, and raised intracranial pressure. So intracranial pressure may rise due to swell or mass effect from a lesion such as hemorrhage, and as we saw last week. As a result, cerebral perfusion pressure is reduced, and ischemia results. When the pressure within the skull rises too high, it can cause brain death or herniation, in which parts of the brain are squeezed by structures in the skull. We saw all this mechanism last week. Thus, part of the management involves reducing and controlling this intracranial pressure. The type, direction, intensity, and duration of forces all contribute to the characteristics or the severity of traumatic brain injury. And forces that may contribute to traumatic brain injury include angular, rotational, shear, and translational forces. Even in the absence of an impact, a significant acceleration or deceleration of the head can cause traumatic brain injury. So in most cases, a combination of impact and acceleration is the cause. And the forces involving the head striking or being struck by something, contact or impact loading, are the cause of most focal injuries, and movement of the brain within the skull, non-contact or inertia loading, usually causes the diffuse injuries. So the violent shaking of an infant can also that causes shaken baby syndrome, commonly manifest as diffuse injury. In impact loading, the forces sends shock waves through the skull and the brain, resulting in tissue damage. Shock waves caused by the penetrating injuries can also destroy tissue along the path of a projectile. So damage may occur directly under the site of impact, or it may occur on the site opposite the impact, that is pull and control pull injuries. And this is when a moving object impacts the stationary head, which is termed as hoop injuries. And while contra coup injuries are usually produced when the moving head strikes a stationary object. So the clinical picture, to help you make a diagnosis, the clinical picture of a patient having traumatic brain injury depends on the type of traumatic brain injury, that is diffuse or focal. And the severity and the part of the brain that is affected also helps in determining this this clinical picture. And some of the clinical manifestations include vomiting, lethargy, headache, confusion, paralysis, coma, loss of consciousness, dilated pupil, vision changes. And others are cerebrospinal fluid coming out of the ears or the nose. So we have CSF rhinorrhea and CSF otorrhea. We have dizziness and balance problems. We have breathing problems. We have slow pulse. We have slow breathing rate with an increase in the pulse, in the blood pressure. This, I think, falls inside the caution triad. And the ringing in the ears, or changes in hearing, cognitive difficulties, inappropriate emotional responses. We have speech difficulties. We have difficult swallowing. We have body numbness or tingling. We also have droopy eyelid or facial weakness. Then we also have a loss of bowel control or bladder control. So the diagnosis is made by having a good history of the patient when you can. You should not just always wait for the history, because some patient can actually be in a coma and you might not have somebody who was the witness of the trauma, if I can put it like that. So you must take a good history when possible. You must do a good physical examination, and you also need a neuroimaging. And this neuroimaging, some of this neuroimaging that you need are computed tomography. We have magnetic resonance imaging. And we have angiography. Sometimes we can even use X-ray of the head. We have an electroencephalography. We have transcranial Doppler. And neuropsychological assessment is important for long-term management and rehabilitation. So we should not neglect this aspect of management. So having seen all this, so how now do you manage a patient who has a traumatic brain injury? So traumatic brain injury management must follow the ATLS protocol. Eventually, a patient with having a traumatic brain injury is a case of trauma. So you must follow the ATLS protocol, all know the different segments, and you must begin emergency treatment within the golden hour following the injury. That is a must if you want to have a better outcome. So moderate to severe injuries are likely to receive treatment in an intensive care unit, followed by a neurosurgical. Followed by a neurosurgical ward. So after managing the emergency, you send the patient in the neurosurgical ward for, I would say, follow-up and continuous management. So the management depends on the recovery stage of the patient. And in the acute stage, the aim is to stabilize the patient and focus on preventing further injury, while rehabilitation is the main treatment for the subacute and the chronic stages of recovery. So in the acute stage, what you need to do is the care of a traumatic brain injury should begin at the site of the injury with an aim to secure the patient's airway and maintain adequate ventilation and circulation. So initial measures include transporting patient to an appropriate care delivery center that is available. During transport and in the hospital, the primary concern are ensuring proper oxygenation. Maintaining adequate blood flow to the brain, and controlling raised intracranial pressure. These are mandatory aspects to take care of when you are managing a patient in the acute stage. So the outcomes in traumatic brain injury patients have been found to be influenced by the transportation method, the duration of transit, and whether responding team is led by a physician or a paramedic. So the primary management goals are the prevention of hypoxia and hypotension, because even a single episode of hypotension has been found to be associated with a doubling of mortality and an elevated risk of morbidity. So secondary brain injury prevention is the primary concern of therapeutic interventions following traumatic brain injury, which can best be managed by an anesthesiologist, and preferably a neuroanesthesiologist, that is preferably. And so let us now look at the different sections in the management of a traumatic brain injury patient. So let us take the airway control and ventilation. Although airway control may be our primary concern in these patients, studies have reported poorer outcomes for traumatic brain injuries, traumatic brain injury patients who were intubated at the site of trauma. Intubation by inexperienced providers showed a fourfold increase in the death and a significant higher risk of worse functional outcome when compared to patients whose airway was secured in the emergency department. Thus, it is suggested that basic airway care performed well in a pre-hospital setting may be significantly better than a pre-hospital intubation that is performed poorly. So it's always better. It would be better to do the basic airway the basic airway management than to intubate a patient when you are not in the appropriate setting. So patients with traumatic brain injury have up to 5% to 6% incidence of an unstable cervical spine injury. Therefore, all attempts at intubation should include in-line neck stabilization to reduce the chance of worsening neurological injury until radiological clearance is obtained. And the pre-existing hypoxia, intracranial hypertension, full stomach, and coexisting injuries such as cervical spine trauma and maxillofacial injuries may be present that predisposes the patient to difficult airway management. Thus, careful preparation and pre-oxygenation is mandatory. So, anesthetic drugs that allow for rapid control of the airway while avoiding an increase in the intracranial pressure and providing hemodynamic stability are preferred. Propofol and the geopentol are the most commonly used drugs, but they may cause hypotension. So it's very important to take note of this statement. So etomidate has advantages in terms of cardiovascular stability, but the possibility of adrenal suppression exists. So ketamine is the popular. I mean, so ketamine is popular in a trauma patient, and the recent evidence suggests that its effect on the intracranial pressure may be limited. So trauma is always better to use ketamine. And for rapid sequence intubation, cysteine, choline, or ropuronium used. Although cysteine, choline may produce a small increase in intracranial pressure, this has not been proven to be clinically significant. And to maintain a response of to a laryngoscopy, an opiate such as fentanyl may be used, but there is no evidence to support the use of lidocaine. Adequate sedation and muscular relaxation tend to reduce the cerebral metabolic oxygen requirement and to optimize ventilation and prevent coughing or straining. So, still on the airway control and ventilation. Ventilation of patients with a severe traumatic brain injury aims to maintain the PCO2 within a normal range of 34 to 38 millimeters of mercury. Hyperventilation should be avoided as increased PCO2 levels may lead to cerebral hyperemia with an increase in blood volume and the intracranial pressure. We saw it in the last presentation. And the hyperventilation, on the other hand, results in an increased risk of vasoconstriction and increased tissue hypoxia, especially in the penumbra zone. So it is best avoided. Fraction of inspired oxygen setting on a ventilator should be adjusted to achieve a PaO2 of approximately 90 millimeter of mercury, which can oxygenate the penumbra zone. And the high PaO2 should be avoided. Considering the risk of hyperoxic cerebral vasoconstriction and the hyperoxic lung injury, we also saw part of this in last presentation. So, the positive end expiratory pressure is a pressure which is applied by the ventilator at the end of each breath to prevent atelectasis. Should be maintained between 5 to 10 centimeter of water, and this may be administered to prevent atelectasis, as already said, and has been proven to be safe in these patients. So, inhalation of beta-2 agonists may induce transient vasodilation with an increase in the intracranial pressure and a reduction in the blood pressure. If this occurs, the dose should be halved for subsequent inhalation therapy. And evidence from recent trials indicate that although early tracheostomy may not be associated with a reduction in the ventilatory-associated pneumonia, ventilatory or intensive care unit days are reduced in this patient. So consequently, the Brain Trauma Foundation has recommended that early tracheostomy should be performed to reduce ventilation days when the overall benefit outweighs the complication associated with the procedure. And this is a level 2 study. So, having seen how to manage the airway and the ventilation aspect, let us now see have an idea about the blood pressure and the cerebral perfusion pressure. So, despite consensus on the principles of early management, there is no widespread agreement on resuscitation goals, as various expert bodies have offered different management guidelines. Initially, the recommendation was to keep the cerebral perfusion pressure above 70 millimeters of mercury with vasopressors if needed. But these subsequent studies showed that outcomes were better with a relatively lower cerebral perfusion pressure, possibly because of the reduced incidence of acute respiratory distress syndrome, secondary to reduced vasopressor usage, which is very important to note. And the fourth edition of the Brain Trauma Foundation guidelines recommend maintaining the systolic blood pressure at greater than or equal to 100 millimeters of mercury for patients 50 to 69 years old, or at the greater than or equal to 110 millimeters of mercury or above for patients 15 to 49 or over 70 years old to decrease mortality and improve outcomes. And this is a level 3 study. So they recommended target cerebral perfusion pressure value for survival, and the favorable outcome is between 60 and 70 millimeters of mercury. Whether 60 or 70 millimeters of mercury is the minimum, whether 60 to 70 millimeters of mercury is the minimum optimal cerebral perfusion pressure threshold is unclear, and they may depend upon the patient autoregulatory status. And this is a level 2 study. So avoiding aggressive attempts to maintain cerebral perfusion pressure above 70 millimeters of mercury with fluids and pressors may be considered. So let us see, have an idea about the fluid management of traumatic brain injury patient. So in a hypotensive traumatic brain injury patient, hypovolemia resulting from extracranial hemorrhage should be first ruled out. Even in the absence of extracranial hemorrhage, hypovolemia can still develop by transcapillary leakage. Although it may be difficult to estimate the extent of hypovolemia, it can be roughly estimated using standard methods such as analysis of the arterial pulse pressure variation, blood pressure response following a fluid challenge or a passive leg raise. So crystalloids are usually poor volume expanders. That is 70 to 80% reaches the interstitial space within 20 minutes of infusion, contributing to general systemic tissue edema. With a disrupted blood-brain barrier, significant passive distribution into the brain interstitial may occur, leading to increased brain edema and increased intracranial pressure, especially if hypotonic solutions are used. So saline is the most common crystalloid used in traumatic brain injury, but ringer lactate is also an alternative too. It's not recommended for something like that. So infusions of large volumes of normal saline results in the adverse hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis that is detrimental in traumatic brain injury. And balanced crystalloid solution may be a good alternative. So colors appear to provide no further benefit, and the safe trial found increased mortality in patients receiving albumin compared to saline. And the traumatic brain injury is associated with the acute kidney injury in many patients, and they often presents with consecutive higher mortality. So colloids are also found to be associated with the increased chances of acute kidney injury and increased use of renal replacement therapy in critically ill patients. Sorry, it's not shown here. So still under fluid management. Recent Cochrane reviews have demonstrated that the use of colloids is not superior to crystalloids for overall mortality, especially in patients with trauma, burns, or post-surgery. So, however, administration in the setting of intact renal function may be considered. Evidence seems to suggest that it is the volume of fluid infused rather than the choice of fluid itself that plays an important role. The outcome following traumatic brain injury is very important to also know. So, having seen that, let us now have an idea about this sedation and analgesia for a patient with traumatic brain injury. So, reducing stress and the adrenocortical response is an important component of traumatic brain injury management. Even unconscious traumatic brain injury patients may have increased blood pressure and increased intracranial, intracranial pressure resulting from these stress responses. So, sedative agents can reduce metabolic stress on acutely injured brain tissue by decreasing cerebral metabolism and the consumption of oxygen in a dose-dependent manner. That is, that in turn decreases the cerebral blood flow and leads to a reduction in the intracranial pressure. So, care should be taken to maintain an adequate mean arterial pressure throughout the duration of sedation. So achieving an adequate level of sedation is paramount because it minimizes the length of hospital stay, ventilatory days, incidence of delirium, and helps in early mobilization. And the latest Brain Trauma Foundation recommendation regarding the use of sedatives and analgesics are as follows. So they are administration of barbiturates to induce burst suppression as prophylaxis against intracranial hypertension is not recommended. Is not recommended, and this is level 2 study. So high dose barbiturates are recommended to control intracranial pressure refractory to maximum standard surgical and medical treatments while ensuring hemodynamic stability. Although propofol may be used for intracranial pressure control, it is not recommended for improvements in mortality or 6-month outcome. So how do you manage how do you monitor intracranial pressure and how do you manage it in patients with traumatic brain injury? Patients with elevated intracranial pressure have been shown to have worse outcomes and are at a higher risk of mortality. The indication of intracranial pressure monitoring in traumatic brain injury from the latest edition of the BTF guidelines are as follows. So we have the management of severe traumatic brain injury patients based on intracranial pressure monitoring may reduce in hospital and the 2-week post-injury may reduce in hospital and 2-week post-injury mortality. Second one is the guideline no longer include a recommendation regarding patients that should be chosen for monitoring because of insufficient high quality evidence. And also clinical judgment should be used to initiate intracranial monitoring in patients who are at a high risk of clinical deterioration. We saw some of this aspect in last week's presentation. So updated BTF guidelines state that intracranial pressure monitoring is a level 2 recommendation and recommend treatment of intracranial pressure greater than 22 millimeter of mercury to reduce mortality. So the management of intracranial pressure includes standardized strategies that use a staircase approach with an escalating treatment intensity. And the American College, of Surgeons traumatic brain injury guidelines recommend a three-tier approach for the management of increased intracranial pressure. So here we have a diagram which shows the staircase approach. So invasive monitoring using the external ventricular drain technique, in which a catheter is placed into one of the ventricles through a borehole, is considered to be the gold standard of intracranial pressure monitoring. Dr. Ulrich said this last week. So in addition to measuring intracranial pressure, this technique can also be used to drain cerebrospinal fluid and administer medicine intrathecally, such as for antibiotic administration in case of ventriculitis. And then additionally, external ventricular drain placement may be indicated to drain post-traumatic hemorrhage. So let's have a look to this diagram. So it's actually a flowchart and everything is being mentioned here. So let's move to osmotherapy in the management of traumatic brain injury. So osmotherapy with mannitol has been used since the 1960s as the main treatment for raised intracranial pressure and remains a component of traumatic brain injury management guidelines. Hypertonic saline has become an alternative during the last 20 years, but controversy remains regarding which solution is the best agent and regarding the best method of administration. So mannitol increases the cerebral blood flow by plasma expansion, decreasing the blood viscosity via deformed erythrocytes and promoting osmotic diuresis. This is what Dr. Kabulo spoke about last week in the comment section. So hypertonic saline promotes a flux of water across the blood-brain barrier and improves blood flow by expanding the plasma volume. He also spoke about this. And the action of intracranial pressure reduction from baseline was significantly higher in subjects treated with hypertonic saline compared with those treated with mannitol. So because of limited evidence, the recommendation of the third edition of the BTF guidelines are as follows. Mannitol in that dosage is effective for the control of elevated intracranial pressure while avoiding hypotension. And this is a level 2 recommendation. So let us look at the multimodal neuro monitoring. So jugular venous oxygenation saturation can be used to estimate the balance between global cerebral oxygen delivery and uptake. A catheter, and how do we do it? We insert the catheter into the dominant internal jugular vein and then advance to the jugular bulb, aiming to minimize the contamination from extracranial venous return. So reduction in the jugular venous oxygen saturation levels below 55% indicates that cerebral oxygen demand may be inadequate to meet demand, usually due to decreased cerebral perfusion pressure or hyperventilation associated with the vasoconstriction. So, controversially, increase indicates excessive perfusion caused by raised cerebral blood flow or decreased oxygen utilization secondary to cell death. Both reduction of less than 50% and greater than 75% after traumatic brain injury associated with the poor outcomes, and the monitoring following traumatic brain injury may lead to improved outcomes. So the Lycox monitor uses a close polarographic electrode to measure focal brain tissue oxygen tension, and the oxygen diffuses across the semi-permeable membrane and produces a current directly proportional to the oxygen concentration. And the measure of the PVRO2 represents the balance between oxygen delivery and cellular oxygenation consumption, and also provides a highly focal analysis of brain milieu and may be used to monitor the potentially salvageable penumbra following traumatic brain injury. So the normal values are between 35 to 50 millimeters of mercury. And following traumatic brain injury, reduced levels have been seen to be associated with poorer outcomes. And cerebral microdialysis is being increasingly used as a bedside tool to provide analysis of brain homeostasis in the intensive care setting. So severe ischemia is usually associated with a significant increase in the lactate pyruvate ratio, and is associated with poor outcomes following traumatic brain injury. And cellular lysis following traumatic brain injury leads to degradation of membrane phospholipids and release of glycerol into extracellular fluid, making it as making it a useful marker in this setting. So cerebral micro cerebral microdialysate concentration of glycerol are typically elevated in first 24 hours after traumatic brain injury, and followed by an exponential decline over the next 3 days. So subsequent increase in the glycerol are associated with poor prognosis and seizures and seizure activity on electroencephalography. And the post-traumatic seizure are a major cause of secondary brain injury following traumatic brain injury. It's very important to note. Are associated with the higher injury severity and the worse outcome. So recent data suggests that seizure occurring in up to 20% of patients with traumatic brain injury. I mean, recent data suggests that seizure occurs in up to 20% of patients with traumatic brain injury. And these seizures are usually non-convulsive in nature and cannot be detected clinically, making a continuous EEG recording a vital tool in diagnosis and management. This Dr. Ulrich mentioned it last week, so it's a very important point. So, the anticonvulsant therapy in the patient with traumatic brain injury is as follows. So, subsequent to traumatic brain injury, convulsive activity results in increased intracranial pressure and altered oxygen supply to the injured brain. So, to prevent a secondary brain injury, many studies have attempted to study the benefit of seizure prophylaxis. Treatment with phenytoin, was effective in decreasing the rate of post-traumatic seizures in the first 7 days of injury, but has no significant role in prevention of post-traumatic seizure after the first week of injury. This point is also very important. So, clinical comparisons of levetiracetam and phenytoin is in prevention of early post-traumatic seizure prophylaxis have found no significant difference in rates of early post-traumatic seizures among patients treated with phenytoin compared with patients treated with levetiracetam. Sorry for the pronunciation. So the current Brain Trauma Foundation guidelines recommend treatment with the anticonvulsants within 7 days of injury. So no randomized control studies have been performed to date to prove that one anti-epileptic drug is better than another in this setting. So this is a good zone of study and research. Temperature management in traumatic brain injury. In clinical practice, even mild hypothermia has been associated with poorer outcomes and longer ICU stays, as it may lead to increased edema and inflammation. So,
excuse me, Zolo. Excuse me.
Yeah. Yes, doctor.
Yeah, could you try moving the mic a little closer to your mouth? It's been suggested. Let's give that a try.
All right. Are you getting me better now?
Yeah, that's good. That's better.
Yes, actually, I'm holding it close to my mouth.
Yeah, that's very good. I'm sorry. I should have asked you sooner.
Okay. Thank you very much. So, okay. Conversely, cooling may be neuroprotective and has been seen to improve outcomes following global brain hypoxia. So, however, the traumatized brain suffers from compromised circulation and hypoxia in the penumbra zone, making it hypersensitive to the adrenergic stress induced by the brain injury itself, which will get aggravated with hypothermia. So some studies reported a significant increase in pulmonary complications in patients treated with a targeted temperature management compared with standard of care. This difference has been explained by the inhibition of fever to fight infection. Also, the recommendation from the Brain Trauma Foundation is that early short-term prophylactic hypothermia is not recommended to improve outcomes. And this is a level 2 study. So as far as glycemic control is concerned, after traumatic brain injury, there is a marked catecholamine surge with cortisol release and glucose intolerance leading to significant hyperglycemia. This is very important to note. Anaerobic metabolism of glucose and the resulting acidosis in the brain may lead to neuronal dysfunction and the cerebral edema. And the impaired cerebrovascular regulation following traumatic brain injury has also been implicated as a reason for poor outcome because of hyperglycemia. And thus, glucose-containing fluid should be avoided and blood sugar monitoring to maintain levels between 4 to 8 millimole per liter. So, for as far as decompressive craniotomy is concerned, craniotomy reduces intracranial pressure by giving extra space to the swollen brain, and it may quickly prevent brainstem herniation, which is one of the fear we have when a patient has a traumatic brain injury. So, the decompressive craniotomy trial included patients who had refractory increased intracranial pressures between 15 minutes and 1 hour of onset. They observed that there were significant fewer medical interventions to decrease intracranial pressure in patients treated with decompressive craniotomy. And however, at the 6 months of follow-up, functional outcome was worse in the decompressive craniotomy group compared with the standard of care group. So the randomized evaluation of surgery with craniotomy for uncontrollable elevation of intracranial pressure trial compared secondary decompressive craniotomy to optimal medical management, and at the 6 months, decompressive craniotomy resulted in a lower mortality than a medical management, but higher rates of a vegetative state and disability. And the result of these trials confirmed that decompressive craniotomy may be a life-saving surgery, but that its outcome, it comes at the expense of higher chances of severe disability among survivors. So the latest BTF guidelines recommend a large frontotemporoparietal decompressive craniotomy as opposed to a smaller one. to target reduced mortality and better neurological outcome, and it's a level 2 recommendation. As far as nutrition is involved, early nutritional support is associated with better outcomes, and the enteral feeding has been found to be beneficial. So ABTF recommends basal caloric replacement by at least the 5th day, and at the most by the 7th day post-injury. And the transgastric intestinal feeding may also be they also reduce the risk of ventilation associated with pneumonia. So patients with a severe traumatic brain injury have gastric feeding intolerance, which may be attributed to dysfunctional gastric emptying secondary to increased intracranial pressure, and the use of opiates. And the prokinetic agents such as metoclopramide may improve feeding tolerance. And the BTF recommends the replacement of 140% and 100% of resting metabolic expenditure in non-paralyzed and paralyzed patients, respectively. However, a lower caloric intake may also be beneficial. So as far as antibiotic therapy is concerned, since traumatic brain injuries are more likely to receive invasive monitoring and invasive monitoring and the therapeutic treatments, including mechanical ventilation, they are also more likely to be an increased risk for developing of infections. Sources of potential infections need to be identified appropriately, and appropriate therapy should be instituted. So a common source of infection is invasive monitoring of intracranial pressure, and the incidence of intracranial pressure device infection has been reported to range from 1% to 27%, which is actually somehow high. And the most studies cited by the BTF guidelines have evaluated prophylactic antibiotic coverage in patients with traumatic brain injury have shown little significant difference in the infection rates. And another study have evaluated patients who received bacitracin flushes and showed a higher rate of infection among the intervention group. So the current guidelines suggest that use of antibiotic impregnated catheters to reduce infection rate. And although this is only a level 3 recommendation, there is limited available data to support the use of antibiotic prophylaxis in traumatic brain injury. And especially as the data suggests that such therapy may predispose this patient to more severe infections. And we all know the third world war is coming, that is the war against bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics. But however, evidence for antibiotic therapy following penetrating traumatic brain injury is reduced, and the therapy should be maintained for at least 7 to 14 days. So for other consideration, patients with traumatic brain injury are at significant risk of experiencing thromboembolic events. So options for prevention include mechanical, pharmacological prophylaxis, or a combination of both. And pharmacological thromboprophylaxis is usually initiated 48 to 72 hours after neurosurgical intervention, and in the absence of other contraindications. Very important to look for the contraindication. So additional care includes a peptic ulcer prophylaxis, physiotherapy, and full hygienic care. The importance of both high quality perioperative intensive care and rehabilitation therapy this patient cannot be overstated, and the proper physiotherapy and the post-discharge care in this patient population has been found to be an independent predictor of mortality and morbidity, as reported by some studies. So in the chronic stage, the management of the chronic stage, once medically stable, the patient may be transferred to a subacute rehabilitation unit of the medical center or to an independent rehabilitation hospital. And the rehabilitation aims to improve independent functioning at home and in society, and to help adapt to disabilities. So rehabilitation has demonstrated its general effectiveness when conducted by a team of health professionals who specialize in the head trauma. And I think it's very important to have such professionals in Africa. And as for any person with a neurologic deficit, a multidisciplinary approach is the key to optimize outcome. So neurologists are likely to be the key medical staff involved, but depending on the person, doctors of other medical specialty may also be helpful. And other health professionals, such as a physiotherapy, speech and language therapy, cognitive rehabilitation therapy, and occupational therapy will be essential to assess function and design the rehabilitation activities for each person, because this is an individualized care given to the patient. The treatment of a neuropsychiatry, which is very important, should not be neglected. Symptoms such as emotional distress and clinical depression may involve mental health professionals such as therapists, psychologists, and psychiatrists, while neuropsychologists can help to evaluate and manage cognitive deficits. After discharge from inpatient rehabilitation treatment unit, care may be given on an outpatient basis. The community-based rehabilitation will be required for a high proportion of people, including vacation rehabilitation and the supportive employment matches job. So let us look at the prognosis. So let us have an idea about the prognosis of the patient. So the prognosis worsens with the severity of the injury. Most traumatic brain injuries are mild and do not cause permanent or long-term disability. However, all severity levels of traumatic brain injury have the potential to cause significant long-lasting disability. So don't just rely on the severity. Maybe saying that because the patient has a mild traumatic brain injury, the prognosis might be better. Yes, somehow it's better, but it still has the ability to move and to be catastrophic. So permanent disability is thought to occur in 10% of mild injuries and 66% of moderate injuries and 100% of severe injuries. So most mild traumatic brain injury is completely resolved within 3 weeks. And almost all people with the mild traumatic brain injury are able to live independently and return to the jobs they had before the injury. Although a small portion have mild cognitive and social impairments. So over 90% of people with moderate traumatic brain injury are able to live independently, although some require assistance in areas such as physical abilities. Most people with severe close head injury either die or recover enough to live independently. Middle ground, and the middle ground is less common. So coma, as it is closely related to severity, is a strong predictor of the poor outcome in patients with traumatic brain injury, and prognosis differs depending on the severity and location of the lesion and access to immediate specialized acute management. So subdural hematoma is associated with the worst outcome and increased mortality, while people with a pedural hematoma are expected to have a good outcome if they receive a surgery quickly. But you should not base yourself on this statement, because as I told you, any patient has the possibility of moving to a severity, to become more severe. So, diffuse abdominal injury may be associated with the coma when severe and it has a poor outcome. Following the acute stage, prognosis is strongly influenced by the patient's involvement in activities that promote recovery, which for most patients require access to a specialized intensive rehabilitation center. And the medical complications associated with a bad prognosis. So patients' characteristics, also like comorbidities, also influence the prognosis of the patient. And the life satisfaction has been known to decrease for individuals with traumatic brain injury immediately following the trauma. But evidence has shown that life roles, age, and the depressive symptoms influence the trajectory of the life satisfaction as time passes. So how do you prevent traumatic brain injury, seeing how dangerous these injuries are? So most traumatic brain injury are vehicle accidents. Their prevention or the amelioration of their consequences can both reduce the incidence and the gravity of the traumatic brain injury. In accidents, damage can be reduced by use of seat belts. So child safety seats and motorcycle helmets, and they prevent the presence of roll bars and airbags. All these help in reducing the severity of the of accident, so in case it's an accident, and thus help to ameliorate traumatic brain injury or to prevent traumatic brain injury. So education programs exist to lower the number of crashes. And additional changes to public, changes to public policy and safety laws can be made. This includes speed limits, seat belt and helmet laws, and road engineering practices. So we see that somewhere the authorities need to be involved. So falls can be avoided by installing grab bars in bathrooms and handrails on the on stairways. Playgrounds with a shock-absorbing surfaces such as sand also prevent head injuries. And child abuse prevention with programs to prevent shaking baby syndrome by educating about the dangers of shaking the baby is also important in the prevention. Also, we have observed that supplementation with omega-3 offers protection against the biochemical brain damage that occurs after traumatic brain, after traumatic brain injury. So let us look, have an idea about the head injury in children. So trauma resulting from fall or traffic accident is even emerging as a leading cause of mortality in pediatric age group. Remember that we call it as being a silent epidemic. So children have an incompletely developed nervous system, and the prognosis of traumatic brain injury is made more complex by anatomical and the physiological variation that distinguish children from adults. So in children, the head is larger in proportion to the body surface area, and the stability is dependent on ligamentous rather than a bony structure. So because of their smaller stature, children are at a significant increased risk of direct brain injury, as their head may be the site of the initial impact and absorption of the higher percentage of the forces applied. So although infants and young children may tolerate intracranial pressure increases better than adults, why? Because the sutures in the brain are not yet, the sutures on the skull are not yet good enough. The presence of the presence of open contact. Yes. So, all this may manifest as a traumatic brain injury may manifest as irritability, crying, vomiting, or rarely as electrocardiogram changes. So this is how a traumatic brain injury manifests in children mostly. And the assessment of neurological status are more complicated in the pediatric population because of the difficulty in assessing responses to various stimuli. So as such, the GCS is modified for use in the pediatric patient. And a recent study from Korea published in 2017 found that age, surgical intervention, subdural hemorrhage, and diffuse axonal injury were predictors for poorer outcomes in the pediatric population. And there is some sort of modified GCS for the children. We have greater than 1 year and less than 1 year. So there's some changes to the adult GCS. So let us have an idea about the complications of traumatic brain injury. The result of traumatic brain injury vary widely in type and duration, and they include physical, cognitive, emotional, and behavioral complications. So traumatic brain injury can cause prolonged or permanent effect on the consciousness, such as coma, brain death, persistent vegetative state, and the minimal conscious state. And the lying still for long period can cause a complication including pressure source, pneumonia, or other infection, and the progressive multiple organ failure and deep venous thrombosis, which can cause pulmonary embolism and even kill the patient before the effects of the traumatic brain injury kill the patient. In case it happened. So, movement disorder that may develop after traumatic brain injury is one of the complications. People may lose or experience altered vision, hearing, or smell. They also have hormonal disturbance that may occur secondary to hypopituitarism occurring immediately or years after injury, 10 to 15% of traumatic brain injury. So it's important to screen a patient who had traumatic brain injury to detect all these secondary manifestations. And traumatic brain injury may cause emotional, social, or behavioral problems and changes in personality. So in conclusion, traumatic brain injury is an epidemic and carries a high morbidity and mortality rate. So various mechanisms are responsible for the effect of traumatic brain injury. Early onset of treatment modalities might help improve the outcome depending on the degree of severity of traumatic brain injury. Rehabilitation is crucial, is a crucial part of traumatic brain injury treatment, so it should not be neglected. And the prognosis will depend on various factors from type of injury to comorbidities. Prevention of traumatic brain injury is vital as some cases might not be treated, might not be treatable, or might be associated with severe complications. Also, studies need to be done to fine-tune knowledge on traumatic brain injury and care delivery to the traumatic brain injury patient. So with that said, these are my references, some of them anyway, because I've not all of them. I will say thank you for your attention. And it's important, this picture is very important because it says, yes, both have umbrellas, but only one is protected. Measure what matters. It is not universal health coverage unless it protects against financial hardship. Thank you very much.
Okay, Zolo, thank you. Thank you very much for another exhaustive presentation. That's the second one in 2 weeks. And just a student. I'd like to introduce a couple of panelists that came a little late. Dylan, can you please introduce yourself? And Vlad, too, also. Go ahead, Dylan.
Hi, everyone. Hello, everyone. I'm Dylan, general practitioner from Cameroon, and member of the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons. Nice to meet you all.
Okay, thank you very much. And Vlad, could you please introduce yourself? Welcome.
Greetings to everyone. My name is Vlad Ionitam, and I'm only a 5th-year student at medical school in Romania. And I'm very happy to be for participating at this presentation. Very wonderful.
Yeah, Vlad, and Vlad is going to be help us edit the Neurosurgery Daily, and we're going to talk about that later. And we welcome editors because we want to put the best out there at the convenience of tapping on the smartphone to see the latest neurosurgery news. And we want people like Vlad to curate all that's out there and help. At any rate, okay, thank you, Zolo. Let's go around and the win. Hello, we get to see your picture now.
Dr. Bennett, there is Darwin.
Go ahead.
Yes.
Hi, Darwin, we can see you. Can you introduce yourself again, please? We didn't see you before.
Hey, doctors, how? Yeah, so I was traveling. I've just tried to settle down now. So I'm Darwin's Chamber, 4th-year medical student from Copperbelt University, Zambia.
Okay, very good, and welcome. Okay, any comments or questions from Dr. Kabulo? Go ahead, why don't you go first?
Thank you so much, Dr. Bennett. I wanted to say something about Darwin. He's a medical student in 4th year in Zambia. So I managed to speak to him a few days ago on Facebook account. On the Facebook page. So he has a case of traumatic brain injury he managed in a research limited center. So if we have time today or maybe next week, we'll ask him to present that case. So we discuss about his case.
Oh, excellent. We'd love to do that.
Zolo, thank you so much. I want to see your smile again.
Yeah, can we see your face, Zolo? That big smile. Yes. Look at that smile, man.
Okay. Thank you so much, Zolo. So this was fantastic. Fantastic presentation.
Very good. He's got a good future as a student, man. He's got a really good future.
Like Dr. Bennett said, it was exhaustive. You went through most of the things. So last week I told you to talk about the head injury. I didn't know that you were the one talking on hydrocephalus, because head injury is important for everyone. All doctors should know about head injury. If I knew that you were presenting today, I could ask you to postpone the hydrocephalus so we only go through head injury. But it doesn't matter. I will just give a few comments. Before I go to the comments, I have one small question before I give my comment. The small question is, you were talking about AOA and intubation. Which patient do you intubate? Which patient with head injury do you intubate?
I think a patient that we patient with head injury that we intubate, a patient that cannot be patient in coma. We have a patient who has a head injury or is in a coma and cannot maintain the pattern airway and so we intubate him to assist him in respiration.
So I guess I had a hard time hearing that last part, Zolo. Could you do, repeat again?
Sorry for the microphone. So I said that a patient that we intubate are patients who are traumatic brain injury patients who are in coma.
Okay, so loss of gag reflex would be an indication, right, Dr. Cabullo?
Then when do you talk about coma in terms of Glasgow Coma Scale?
It's when the GCS is below 8.
Okay, when Glasgow Coma Scale is 8 and below, that's where you talk about coma. Those patients, we intubate them because they can't protect their airways. They don't have a cough reflex. They have a risk of aspiration. So that's why we intubate those ones. Above 8, you don't intubate unless there is another indication. But 8 and below, it means the patient is in coma. You have can't protect his airways. So that was the only question I had. So my few comments, you said ringer lactate is alternative. Yes, people are still using ringer lactate as a fluid for resuscitation in head injury. Like I told you, it depends now on the centers. Like us, we prefer normal saline than ringer lactate because ringer lactate, its osmolarity is slightly lower than plasma osmolarity. So it might worsen the edema. But other centers are still using it as the primary fluid of resuscitation. So there was even a study which was done last time, like I mentioned last week, about ringer lactate and saline. But still, it depends on the center where you are. Another thing I wanted to mention is about seizure prophylaxis. Seizure prophylaxis is a very important thing in head injury because we always classify seizure, post-traumatic seizure, into three types. There is immediate seizure, early post-traumatic seizure, and late post-traumatic seizure. So immediate, they used to classify it as seizures which occur within 24 hours after the accident. And early, it's up to 7 days. And from 7 days onward, it's late post-traumatic seizure. Now, these days, they tried to narrow it down. Like, they are talking about immediate post-traumatic seizures. Those seizures which occur soon after the accident, those are the immediate post-traumatic seizures. So, how do you give prophylaxis? A patient who comes with post-traumatic seizures, if it's immediate and early, you give anti-seizure prophylaxis for 7 days. But if it's late post-traumatic seizure, you give anti-seizure prophylaxis at least for 1 year, and there are criteria before you stop. When do you discontinue? There are criteria for you to discontinue that. But if the patient has early or immediate post-traumatic seizure, you give anti-seizure prophylaxis for 7 days. After that, the patient comes back after 2 weeks with seizures. Then you classify them as late post-traumatic seizures. Then you continue more than a year or 2 years with the anti-seizure prophylaxis. And also, even those patients who didn't have seizures, but they have severe traumatic brain injury, you should give anti-seizure prophylaxis. Because those patients, usually they have subclinical seizures. So you have to give prophylaxis. Then according to like what you mentioned, it was nice. We prefer phenytoin. Why? Because phenytoin is non-sedative anti-seizure. Non-sedative anti-seizure. Because if you give a sedative anti-seizure, the moment the patient will start to deteriorate, you won't know because the patient will be sedated. So that was my comment. The other comment is on antibiotics. Antibiotics, we don't give in head injury. Like you mentioned also other studies, there's no role for antibiotics unless you are taking the patient to theater for a procedure, then you give prophylaxis antibiotics before operation. And those impregnated catheter, sometimes people don't recommend to use them because they have antibiotics. The moment you get infection now in patient and you want to collect a sample to send to the lab, it will be sterile because the catheter has antibiotics. It won't grow anything when you're doing your culture. It won't grow because it has antibiotics. So even like for external ventricular drain, when you are doing, you get traumatic brain injury with subarachnoid hemorrhage and post-traumatic hydrocephalus. You do your external ventricular drain, usually they don't prefer the one with antibiotics because if there is infection, it won't grow anything because the antibiotics will kill the bugs. So we could spend more time on this topic, even sleep on this panel, but unfortunately you have another presentation, so I have to stop by here. I don't know if there is a comment or a question from anyone before we proceed to the next presentation.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Hello, Ivan. It was a nice presentation. Really full and no image. You know, sometimes it's good that you should put images to when you're talking about surgery, you know. When you don't put images, it's cool. It's full. It's really interesting, but images usually change a little bit our, you understand, it captivates a little bit more. But the question I have for you is, do you really understand what you call secondary lesions or secondary lesions? Do you know what secondary lesions rotates about when they call, especially the anoxic or the hypoxic parts of the secondary lesions?
Thank you very much, Dr. Natalie, for the question. And secondary lesion, they mostly occur like they differ from primary lesion in that primary lesion are what have been their lesions caused in the brain by the direct trauma, like the agent causing the trauma is responsible for the primary injury. Like when maybe they say blue, what happens at the instant is the primary injury, all the dysfunction that happens, the axonal tear and all the rest. Now, secondary lesions that occur, those lesions that occur as a result of what the primary injury caused, like maybe it's going to alter the permeability of the blood vessels in the brain, it's going to alter the availability of oxygen supply to the brain, and all these are what causes the secondary injury to the nerve tissue. So these come as a result of altered in the physiology of the brain. So that's what I understand.
Okay, very good. I wanted to tell you that, do you know the formula to calculate the cerebral perfusion pressure? The formula. Do you know how do they calculate the cerebral perfusion pressure?
Oops, Zolo.
Zolo, unmute yourself.
You're muted, Zolo.
Sorry.
That's all right.
Yeah, so the cerebral perfusion pressure is calculated by subtracting the intracranial pressure from the mean arterial pressure.
Yeah, she wasn't there last Saturday. We understand.
No, I just wanted to tell him that. No, I know. I just wanted to tell him that you gave us some values about the BTF, which they came out for people who are less than 60 and those who are greater than 70. If you come out with somebody who is having, for example, you give us some fixed values of the blood pressure that person should have. I just want to say that if a person who is like hypertensive has a trauma, do you think it would be better for him to be kept within those values, or it would be better for you to calculate the CPP by yourself using your intracranial pressure, and your mean arterial pressure?
Yes. Thank you very much for the question, Dr. Natalie. I think given that the patient is already a hypertensive patient, his physiology is altered. So I would rather calculate the value for the patient. I would not use the standard ones because patient with hypertension, even in their management, maybe when they have to be an agent or agency, we try to keep the values within a particular range. So we don't try to keep them in the normal range. Just like to keep the ICP range. So I'll use an ICP range to calculate ICP.
Okay, thank you.
Dr. Gabullo, could you comment on that question by Nathalie? Did you hear the question? Did you comment on Natalie's question? Could you comment on that?
And yes, maybe Natalie. Come again?
Yeah, could you repeat the question for Dr. Gabullo?
I was asking Zolo that is it not better for you to calculate the CPP yourself, depending on the patient that you have? Because what I wanted to add to Zolo is that exactly you said that there are changes that they call, in French they call it axos. There are different metabolisms which have changed. You can find yourself having a patient who is either hypotensive. You can have a patient because of cerebral trauma, or you can have a person having either normal blood pressure or higher blood pressure due to the consequence. So instead of taking those values that the BTF takes, I was asking him, is it not better for you to calculate yourself and estimate that if the CPP remains between 60 and 70, I think that it should be it's ideal.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Natalie. Those values, they are giving you the range, like what he said, from 50 to 70. It means if it's below that, you will get cerebral ischemia. It means you calculate yourself, then you check, is the value between the range or it's below or it's above. So you have everyone, you have to calculate. You have to calculate because they won't give you the cerebral perfusion pressure. You have to check from the map, you have to check the ICP, then you take map minus ICP, you get your cerebral perfusion pressure. Then you check the range he gave. Is the value within the range or not? Then you decide to say, okay, this one is normal or it's not normal. I don't know if you get it. Whatever he said, it doesn't mean that all patients have to be there. No, it's just the range of normal cerebral perfusion pressure. Then you calculate your patient and check now, is the value normal or not? I don't know if I answered.
Okay, did you hear that?
Yeah, it's okay.
Okay.
Now, I have a question for you, Dr. Kabulo. Okay. Me in Cameroon, I've never seen anywhere being measured, the ICP being measured. What are the other alternatives that we have to measure the ICP? Because us, we don't have the machines for that. We don't have the tools for that.
Yeah, that's common. In Africa, many centers don't have ICP monitoring. So what we do sometimes is to do what is called neuro observations where you are checking your BPs, your pulse, your Glasgow Coma Scale, your pupils. So you do those things and see if the patient is deteriorating or not. If you are taking the patient to theater, then during operation, if you want to put, for example, an external ventricular drain, then you can measure from there in theater using the catheter you're going to place in the ventricles. So not every centers have core centers have ICU monitoring, ICP monitoring. Sorry. So sometimes we just do neuro observations, like I said. But in other centers where they have almost everything, they do. But not every patient, again, requires what? ICP monitoring. There are indications which one to do ICP monitoring, which one not to do.
Okay.
Now it's for Zolo. Zolo, I just wanted to tell you that when a patient who has this is just an addition, when a patient has a traumatic brain injury, when he goes out of the hospital, you have to make what they call the Glasgow Coma Outcome Scale. Do you know about it?
Did you hear that, Dr. Gabullo?
No, Glasgow Outcome Scale.
Outcome Scale, Glasgow, yeah, sorry. Outcome. Glasgow Outcome Scale.
Yes, yes. I read over it some while ago. I just forgot to include it in the presentation. Sorry. Yes.
Thank you very much, Ivan.
That's very important. When you are discharging your patient, you have to know the Glasgow outcome score at discharge, or you can review a patient after 1 month and check the Glasgow outcome score. There is a modified one. Thank you.
Okay. I have a follow-up question.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, Darwin.
So Dr. Natalie mentioned about hypertensive patient. So I would want to find out which patient is more advantaged, hypertensive patient or hypotensive patient, because we know that CPP depends on the blood pressure, which is systolic blood pressure and diastolic blood pressure. So in a patient who has hypertension, are they more advantaged in a case of traumatic brain injury, or maybe they're disadvantaged? Because in the calculation of mean arterial pressure, we use systolic blood pressure and diastolic blood pressure.
Thank you, Darwin, for that question. That's a very good question. Hypotension you have to avoid in a patient with head injury. Because if the patient gets hypotension, hypovolemia, the prognosis will be poor. But hypertension is actually good in patients with traumatic brain injury. That's why they get Cushing triad. Because the more you get elevated systolic blood pressure, the more you are improving your cerebral perfusion pressure. That's why they say a patient with severe traumatic brain injury, you don't lower with the Cushing triad, you don't lower your systolic blood pressure below 160, 140. No, it's contraindicated. Because that high blood pressure is helping you with cerebral to maintain cerebral perfusion pressure. Did you get me?
Yes, that's interesting. I've gotten you well.
Hypertension is better than hypotension. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Okay.
Okay. I have a. Go ahead. Go ahead, Darwin. Go ahead. Go ahead, Darwin. You have another question.
Do you have another question?
I think we lost his audio. Well, while we're waiting to get reconnect with Darwin, I have a comment. As an ex-emergency physician, I'm not a neurosurgeon. We used to see patients come into the emergency room that had therapeutic levels of Dilantin, but they had seizures. And they've discovered through genomics that some people metabolize Dilantin well and some don't metabolize it at all. So in other words, they're resistant to the effects of Dilantin. In that case, have you seen many patients, post-traumatic brain people, that still have seizures, even though they have a therapeutic level of Dilantin? Have you seen any patients that still have seizures, even though their Dilantin level is good, is therapeutic? Have you seen many patients like that?
Yes. We do have patients like that.
Yeah, because you know they've discovered that some people don't metabolize Dilantin well, and you have to use an alternative. What alternative drug do you suggest in that scenario?
Okay, in that one, like the levetiracetam.
Yeah, the one doesn't help stop the seizures. Yeah.
Yes, then you can go with carbamazepine.
Okay.
Yes. It's also a good alternative.
Do you try to avoid Valium because it obtuns the patient briefly?
Yes.
Okay. Because it makes the patient drowsy, and you don't know why they're drowsy. You don't want the drug to cause the drowsiness.
Even phenytoin, we don't give it for long period because it has effect on cognitive.
Maybe to stop a status, right?
Yes.
Status epilepticus.
Okay. Dr. Natalie?
Yes, I was saying that I've also seen used valproate sodium.
Yes.
Or phenobarbital. I don't know what you think about that.
Yes. But phenobarb usually we avoid because it's sedative, especially when the patient is still admitted. We are fearing like the patient will be sedated, the patient will be deteriorating. You will think like it's the sedation due to phenobarb. You get my point?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes, so it's better to use non-sedative anti-seizure.
is that I don't remember having ever seen Finito in Cameroon, actually.
Oh, okay.
So I'm just like I don't think I've even ever seen it, because even when we were doing a presentation on epilepsy, mm-hmm. I remember they were talking much more about phenytoin, but yeah, seriously, we use either benzodiazepines or barbiturates or I don't know, carbamazepine, but really I've never seen phenytoin in Cameroon.
Yeah, sure. Phenytoin is not, like, even in my country, in Lubumbashi, when I was there last time, I could not find phenytoin. So I got a patient, I was using carbamazepine.
Okay, we're having another presentation, Zolo. I wasn't sure whether you guys are going to do another one. Are you going to do another presentation, or that's it?
No, there is a presentation of acute hydrocephalus. I have the presentation. If it's possible, let's...
Then, sure.
But let me end this one formally, and then we'll start the hydrocephalus one. Okay.
Can I ask a question to Darwin?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, Darwin.
Yeah. Yeah. Sure.
Go ahead, Darwin.
Okay. Yes, Darwin. Yes. Your case. How long do you think you can present that case you managed?
I think much of it has been talked about by Zolo. So I think it's just a few things, a few highlights of how we manage the patient and some of the challenges that are usually faced in our setting.
Because I had the suggestion, Dr. Bennett, since we are talking about traumatic brain injury, Darwin case is brain injury. If we can give him 5 to 10 minutes just to give us a case presentation, how that patient presented, how they managed the case, then we move on to hydrocephalus. I don't know. That's just a suggestion.
What do you want to have a separate presentation next week, maybe, on that?
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay.
Yeah.
Even that is fine as well. It's fine.
Yeah, that would be good because I guess Zolo has the hydrocephalus presentation planned.
Yeah.
So let's go with that, and next week Darwin can include that in the presentation.
Okay. Sure. No problem.
Okay, and we'll teach you how to screen share and how to use this platform. Any comments, Vlad, or you want to say anything? You don't have to. You can just say thank you very much.
No, thank you very much. As I said, it's okay, quite an honor for me. I wrote as much as possible about everything that Zol has said because it was very detailed.
Yeah,
I mean, he went from drug uses to nutrition and everything. It was very nice.
Well, it's very great nice. That you guys are going over this now, because you're going to have to learn it. As Dr. Cabullo knows, you have to learn it. And just by repeating it again and again is great. It's really good. So let's end this formally, and then we'll go on to the hydrocephalus. So thanks, everybody.